Good morning to all of you. I think Babu has given a good introduction to the subject, so I need not repeat what he has been mentioning. My paper is on what he talked about, it standardization, which was attempted in medieval South India, a part of medieval South India. You know, I think all of you know, so it was in medieval period, there were several states in South India. My work is mostly on the southern part, that is using the inscriptions from Tamil language. See, in South India, we have four major languages, Tamil, Malayalam, Kannada, and Telugu. Of course, the matter is common to all this linguistic area. So this linguistic area, the southern linguistic area, is somewhat different from other parts of India. In northern India and middle what we call the Deccan, they use sources mostly derived from Sanskrit and Sanskrit-based sources. But in southern India, even though we have some use of Sanskrit, but most of the material are local material, which can be explained only from the study of the local languages. So these, my sources are mostly a large number of inscriptions. There are thousands of inscriptions in South India, particularly in Tamil and Kannada languages. And for the period between 9th century and 13th century, we have more than 15,000 inscriptions. Well, these inscriptions are mostly donations, records of donations made to temples. So they are mostly what you call religious kind of sources. But at the same time, we get a lot of other information accidentally, by instantly, other kinds of political, social, and economic information. So as historians, we can derive much of the information from these inscriptions. Of course, each inscription gives only a bit of information. So we have to put together number of inscriptions of a particular period to get a connected picture. So my work is mainly on what's called the Chola period between 9th century and 13th century. During this period, the Chola state covered a major part of South India. There was another state, equally big state, which was called the Chalukya state in Karnataka area. But this Chola state, they were fighting with each other. Of course, these things were continuous. And of course, this Chola state covered a part of Kannada area also, Karnataka, and major part of Tamil Nadu and Kerala, and also parts of Sri Lanka. During the 11th century, the Chola state was at its high point, and some of the rulers of the 11th century, they tried to make much centralization of the administrative structure. So this information which I am going to present, mostly from that 11th century and the following century. Here, from the inscriptions, we get names of various measures, grain or liquid measures, land measures, and weights and other things also. But being mainly a period of natural economy, even though the measures were there, they were not used everywhere in the same way. So there was a lot of diversity, as he was referring to. And in the inscriptions, we get the names of these measures in various contexts. And these measures are found in two different ways. They are indicated in two different ways. One by their names, by words, and the other by notations. Even the numbers, you don't get the actual numbers which we use in modern times. They use only notations for the numbers. And another interesting thing is, even though from 6th century onwards, most parts of India started using the place value system of numbers and also zero, strangely, the southern part, particularly Tamil area, they did not use it. They continued to use the old system of only notations with what you call additive numbers. They don't use the place value system. Anyway, these numbers, they have only notations or names. So we don't have any numbers. So I have just to give you some examples. So these are the names of the measures. See, the third column is the equivalent in modern numbers. So the middle part and the first column, they are found alternatively or side by side. Both are indicated. Sometimes notation as well as the name, both are found in the same inscriptions. And as far as these liquid or grain measures are concerned, we have very limited number of measures. From the lower denomination to the higher denomination I have given. So first is araku, then the last is kalam. These are found very often in the context of grain or liquid measures. We have some equivalent in modern terms that I will discuss later. So araku, uraku, uri, nari, like that. So kalam is the highermost denomination in liquid measure, and the subdivisions are like that. So arak is the lowermost denomination. But very often you find only the last three, that is the higher denominations only, are used in the context of administration. These are the land measures. Actually, inscriptions give most of the, because the land donations are made to the temples. In that context, they refer to the land measures. And again, the government, for tax purpose, they also have to use the land measures only. So very often we get the names of these land measures in the inscriptions. So here again, as in the case of liquid measures, you have notations and names. See this, so just to read it, keel, okay, keel is, I will just explain it later. Then mundri is the smallest denomination in land measure. That is 1 by 320. Then kani, arekani. Arekani is half kani. This half, it is, I only give half in modern number. It is not there in inscriptions. Just to make it clear, I put it half. Otherwise, it is called arai kani. Arai is in Tamil, half. Then kani, arai ma, three kani, ma, arai kal, three ma, four ma, kal, arai, mukal. This make up almost all the necessary fractions of the land measure. So you can write any extent of land by using these fractions, and then we have the whole numbers up to 10, 10 and 100, 1,000. So these are the whole numbers, 1, 2, 3, up to 10, you have different symbols. Then for 100, there is another symbol. Then for 1,000, there is another symbol. After that, it is repeated. So 1,000, 100, 1102, like that. So these are again, like in Roman numerals, they are placed side by side. So using these numbers and the fractions, they write everything in the inscriptions regarding the land measures. And as far as these numbers, they are also used in the context of liquid or grain measures to say how much quantity of liquid. So that is as an attribute to liquid measures. These numbers can be found there also. These whole numbers as well as the fractions can be found there also. But anyway, in all these cases, either notations or names only are found in the inscriptions. No Arabic numerals, which we use nowadays. Well, sometimes when we publish these inscriptions, in modern publications, they convert these old numbers into modern numbers. That is, just to make it easy for the reading public. Otherwise, these numbers only are found in the old inscriptions. So I'll just read, and I think it is already circulated. I will explain that. The standard liquid measures, as I just mentioned, there are Kalam, Kurini, Marakal, Nari, and their lower denominations. Generally, they are mentioned by their names and occasionally by their notations. So that I have explained. In land measures, the highest denomination is Veli, approximately equivalent to 2.68 hectares. Well, this is according to 19th century reference. And the lowest is the Kuri. Usually, a Veli was considered equivalent to either 2,000 Kuri or 2,560 Kuri. Actually, Kuri is a small area measure. So multiples of Kuri made up a Veli. So there were two kind of reckoning, either 2,000 Kuri of Veli or 2,560. These are two major differences in certain areas. There are also some other reckonings. There are some minor variations are there. Veli had some subdivisions that I have explained, the frequent ones being Ma, 1/20, then Kani, 1/80, and Mundiri, 1/320. In addition to these are the primary fractions. Then, of course, quarter, half, and three quarters, that they have also names and notations. Here also, the units are mentioned mostly by their names and sometimes by their notations. The fractions of these, there are fractions. Suppose if you want fractions less than 100, 1/320, that is what's called Mundiri. There are fractions even less than 1/320. For that, they add what's called Keel Mundiri. Yeah. So this keel, that within brackets, I have put keel, that notation is the first one. This means you have, if a fraction is given and if it is this keel precedes that, that means that fraction is to be divided again by 320. So keel ri means half divided by 320. So that way, very small fraction. So this way, there is a secondary series. And again, there is a third series, tertiary series. In inscriptions, you have up to fourth series. That I have given in the text I have given. You can see that number multiplied by half was called keeled array. We come across still lower fractions, keeled, then again keeled three times. It is from the context we can understand which is the fraction, whether first primary or secondary or tertiary. The above mentioned names of land and liquid measures are found to be prevalent all over the territory of the Chola state. That may imply a uniform meteorological system over all the area. Ironically, it is a superficial impression, as there are found to exist variations in the measuring instruments employed in different places. So these are only names of the units. But when we actually see the measures, the instruments which were used for measuring, these instruments, they differ from place to place. Each village and even some big temple possessed their own measuring rods, grain measures, weights, etc. So they are mentioned according to their name. These temples measure, these villages measure, like that. They have different names according to the location. There are also indications of simultaneous existence of royal or state measures along with the local measures. The land measuring instrument is simply mentioned as kol, which means in Tamil rod or pole. Actually, we do not know how it looked like, because we don't have any remains of the old. These were maybe made of wood. They were not preserved. But some of the 19th century accounts of the colonial administrators, they describe that some kind of pole they were using in some localities. But it is not preserved in any museum. This is a linear measure. Kol, that is rod, is a linear measure based on either human span or human foot. So they have different names. Chan is span, and foot is the foot of adi. A rod was named according to the number of spans or feet it comprised. So like 16 span rod, it was called 16 chan kol, 16 chan kol, or foot rod, 12 foot rod. We have again different foot rods. The most popular kind of rod was the 16 span rod. I have given this here in the in the circulated paper, and you can see at the back there are different kinds of rods are given. The foot rods seem to have come into use only after 1100. So earlier span rods were popular. The popular rod of this category was the 12 foot rod. Besides the span and foot rods, there were rods named after villages, temples, rulers, etc. Bereft of the information as to their lengths, they don't mention their lengths. These names are not of much use for comparative purpose. Now the question arises whether the rods having similar names are equal in length everywhere. Because in one locality, 16-span rod is found. In another locality, also 16-span rod is there. But whether we can say both the span rods of both places are of the same length, we cannot be very certain. Because this span and foot were taken by some human, local person. So there is no standard person. So we cannot say they were same everywhere. Unless a government takes some interest and prescribes a particular person as a standard person, sometimes the king's foot is also mentioned, a uniform span or foot would be difficult to attain everywhere. There is some empirical evidence to say that the government tried occasionally to fix the length of the local rods. In some temples, sometimes on natural rocks too, the length of the rod was indicated by a line, that is by some engraving, by a line between two marks, with some mark in between to show the subdivisions. A perusal of the lengths of these rods shows quite a variety among them, with different lengths that I have given in the paper, the appendix. Then we go to the area. how area was measured. A square area, as I mentioned earlier, measuring one rod in length and one rod in breadth was called kuli. Kuli means a pit. Usually in Tamil it is pit, but it has another meaning as square. It need not be just a square, it may be also a rectangle. Anyway, it is four sides. It will have four sides. So this was called kuli. The extent of kuli will vary according to the length of the particular rod which was used in the context. For example, a kuli by 16 span rod will not be equal to a kuli by 12 span rod, but the names are same. In both cases, they mention only name, kuli, unless they refer whether it is a kuli by 12 span or 16 span, we cannot be certain what was the area. If we consider this fact along with the Veli kuli equation, because sometimes one Veli consisted of 2000, sometimes it was 2560, sometimes there are other variations also, it may not be illogical to say that a Veli of 2000 kuli in one village is not identical with that of 2000 kuli in another village, unless there is specific reference to identical rods in both the places. A few inscriptions which give information about the Veli kuli equation and the local measuring rod help us in this regard, that I have given in the table. A Veli of 2000 kuli was measured by the span rod, 16 span rod, at two places, and by 12 span foot rod at another place, by 18 foot rod at two other places. Everywhere it is the same kuli, but rods are different. So it's difficult to compromise these divergent practices. There was another uncertainty due to the prevalence of different Veli kuli equations in one and the same village. So these divergent metrological practices might not have posed problems for local small-scale commercial activities, transactions. Well, in most context, the transactions were of barter kind, but there were also cash transactions, small scale as well as big scale. In small scale transactions, they were used lower denomination of coins, and sometimes by other things, by gold weights also. But in large transactions, they were used coins. Anyway, these divergent mythological practices might not have posed for local small-scale commercial transactions because it is within a village or within a small locality. But those would have certainly created administrative problems and confusion for the state machinery while collecting the taxes from the villagers. Those days, taxes were mostly on land. To some extent, commercial transactions, commercial commodities also are taxed, but the major taxation for the government of medieval times was land tax. There are clear indications that the Chola state tried to introduce some standardization in various measurements to tackle the existing metrological confusion. The government started to use its own measurements along with the local measurements. So these we can differentiate by their names. The state measurements have different names, either according to the king or some other general name is given. This practice meant that the government tax collectors, but at the same time, the government did not impose the measurements upon all the localities. That is, you should not use the local measurements, you should use only government measurements. There is no such dictation, there is no such order. So they permitted the local measurements, but at the same time, for their own purpose, the government officers, they used their own measurements. So both measurements were in use simultaneously in the same place. This practice meant that the government tax collectors had to link wherever and whenever necessary the local measurements to the government measurements by fixing a ratio between the two groups. In most cases, the local area the local measurements alone were involved in calculating the actual area of the taxable land and the grain produce on the, from that land, as in the following example. I have given one example. So there is a small inscription. Even though it is a small inscription, it is a very complicated calculation. See, first, they mentioned the kuli, how many, because the kuli is the basic area which is measured by using the pole, by the rod. So the surveyor, whoever is he is there, the local surveyor, he has to measure kuli by kuli, how many, by using the rod. So for their basic information, they mentioned so many kulis are there in this plot. So here in one plot, it is mentioned that that plot had 87 3/4 and 1/20 of kulis. Well, you forget the fractions, 87 kulis are there. So this is actually measured in that area for that small plot of land. Then what they do for recording, they say according to the local measure, what is called by village measure, they convert it to this whole numbers, that is the Veli Karni. They say it is 1/40 and 1/320, 1/320 of 1/320, so that fraction. So that is given there. So this is according to the village measure. Then for government measure, they have to reconvert the village measure into government measure, that is called Madak, standard land. Then again they give what is the equivalent in fractions. So the kuli is reduced into that whole numbers, veli numbers, and that veli, ordinary veli, that is local veli, is converted to government veli, government land, government denomination. So these are all given, all these given are in numbers. Actually, this I have just give you, sorry, yeah. So this is a small inscription just to give you an idea. So how they write, see, these are the, in between you have these notations. And the notations, they go on line by line. Yeah.
Is it
the
village
measure
that is the photo, or are there two colors in the inscription? It seems that
there are white and gray. Yeah, this is on stone, it is inscribed. So this is an impression, impression on paper. So black is background, the letters are in white. Well, that's due to photography, that different shades. So this is the actual thing. It is in Tamil, and I have given the notations. I have converted into numbers, modern numbers. But actually, it is in notations. So all these are in notations. The three categories are three notations are there. And actually, I tried to practice these notations in and modern numbers together, and for economic saving the space, the notations are easier. Notations are more useful than writing the names or the modern numbers, because modern numbers you have that denominator and numerator. They don't have this thing. They just give you the names. So if they say ma, it is 1/20. And so just one symbol will be enough for 1/20. One mundri, 1/320 is just one word or one small symbol. Like that, it is very easy to write. Yeah, okay. So this is the way they were doing the conversions. Even though it is a small, actually this inscription, which is a brief inscription in 13th century, it gives you the measurements for five plots. Everything in plots, everything into in the three categories: first measurement, then conversion into local measurements, and the government measurements. And then they add all the five plots. Again, they give you the same kind of description in three categories. For taxation purposes, the area and produce were recalculated mentally in terms of the government measurements, and the recalculated quantities were entered in the government account books. So this is the usual practice. They measure locally, and the local accountant, whoever writes the first accounts, he has to convert that again to communicate to the government. Then I will discuss how this standardization was attempted. Along with the introduction of its own measurements, the Chola government took steps to classify land into certain grades. Grade is called the Taram, according to their fertility, irrigation, and other factors. Well, of course, these are not specifically mentioned. Sometimes we can infer from the context. This grading of land seems to have started in the Brahmadeya villages. Brahmadeya is the villages newly created for Brahmin settlers. The Brahmins who are well-versed in Vedic rituals and also in the Sanskrit language, these were invited from many places, and they were settled in certain localities by all the kings all over India. And in South India, it started from 8th century onwards. And in these newly created villages, you find the first references to the kind of the grading the lands, because they have to grade the land in the village so that they can give equal shares to all the Brahmin families. So they have to give one share to one family, and these shares should be equal. There should not be any variations from one family and another family. That was the purpose of this grading in the beginning. So actually, the first references are found in these Brahmin villages in the early 9th century. Then we find in all other villages also. The norms under which the grading was done are not explicitly mentioned. The available irrigation facilities, etc., would have formed the basis. Though classification grades are mentioned, there are mentioned in a good number of inscriptions information regarding the proportionate ratios between the different grades, and the assessments thereon is very rare. So the grades are mentioned like this: first grade, second grade, like that. There are nearly 20 grades are mentioned in some areas. An extension of the grading of this land was to decide a standard valley for tax purposes. So that is the ultimate purpose. The standard land was denoted by the term madak in Tamil, which means fold. So they have to, the ordinary land is folded, clubbed. The standard land was arrived at by calculating a ratio of conversion to the actual extent of the ordinary land as measured on the field. This process was denoted by the phrase to grade and fold. Naturally, this conversion resulted in the shrinkage of the original extent in terms of the standard unit. Thus, according to an inscription of 1044, a land measuring 2.8 valley was reduced to 0.462 valley in extent. The ratio in this case is 6.515 to 1. So that is original land, 6 valley becomes 1 valley of standard land. The ratio of such conversion are known from several instances I have given in the table. There are different, according to grades, they differed. Sometimes even 96 valleys were converted to 1 standard valley. The above information relating to Taram, that is standard, Madak, would have been useful had it been provided with the corresponding rates of assessment. Unfortunately, such things are only rarely mentioned in inscriptions alongside the details of classification. An inscription dated 1142 gives a glimpse into the complicated nature of the classification assessment. This inscription records a sale of some plots of land measuring totally 12.4 veli by the administrative body of the village to an individual who got it for gifting to the temple. The plots belong to four different grades as per the classification made in the year 1122 and entered as such in the classification register. Each village had a register under the supervision of an officer. So there were four grades which were sold here, 3.99 veli of 10th grade, 5 veli of 11th, 2.9 veli of 12th, and 0.125 veli of 13th grade. So this 3.9 etc., it is my own conversion. Originally they have given in notations. All these plots of four grades, when clubbed together into standard grade, were estimated to be equal to 0.24 veli of standard land. As the prevailing rate of land tax was for one madaku or standard veli was 3,175 kalam, the above land would yield, according to these conversions, 778 kalam. This quantity, again, divided by the area of the original land, would give an average rate of 62.5 kalam. So they make it an average. And then they say it was stipulated that this rate should not be altered in future under any circumstance. So this quantity, 3,000 and odd quantity, is for government purpose. But for villagers, it is 62.5 kalam because they have their own land according to the local measurements. So they are asked to pay every year 62 kalam per year, whether they change the classification later or not. It should be permanent arrangement according to this inscription. It was stipulated that this rate should not be altered in future under any circumstances because it is a grant for ritual purpose. They said it should be permanent. Whether the village lands are reclassified or the tax is paid without classification. The Sabha, which is the administrative body of the village, undertook to bear themselves any additional payment that may arise due to such future classification assessment changes. Here, this is the point which I have to make. The information analyzed so far would suggest that in each and every context of fixing the government tax on land, the tax officials and the local bodies, particularly their accountants, had to use two kinds of measurement, one local and the other official. Here, the measurement might have taken into account the area as well as the quality of the land. The local measurement is the real one made on the field, and the official one is that arrived by calculation on the basis of some conversion scale and entered in the classification and assessment register of the government. For a proper and meaningful communication with the citizens, both the measurements were often indicated in terms of taram, madaku, and parappu categories. That for the accountants of the medieval times, so this is the thing which we have to study. I think Roy will be presenting a paper on Kanakadhigaram later. So this is in relation to that Kanakadhigaram which Babu also mentioned. Such conversion calculation was necessary and inevitable part of their job. That is fully attested by the problems discussed in the traditional mathematical works like Kanakadhigaram, which devotes several pages, several problems to solving the conversion problems, such as they pose a problem. So like this, given a land measured by 20-foot rod, how much it would become by 40-foot rod? So this is one problem in this mathematical book. If a piece of land with the extent of 30 kuli, as measured by a 10-foot rod, paid a tax of 15 panam, panam is cash, what would be the tax on 10 kuli of land measured by 20-foot rod? So there are several such problems in this Kanakadhigaram text. Actually, these Kanakadhigaram, they can be dated from, at the most, from 15th century onwards. We do not have any earlier texts available for our comparison purpose. should during 12th century or 13th century, we don't have any mathematical texts. We have other literature, not mathematical texts. So we cannot compare. But these later texts, they are useful for understanding the problems raised by the inscriptions. And again, these notations, the fractions, notations which are found in these inscriptions, this is 12th century, 13th century. Earlier, from 10th century onwards, we have such kind of notations. And almost all same notations are found in the Kanakadiharam texts also. So in the 10th, 11th century, this paleography became a standard. It had developed to the maximum. And after that, there is very minimal changes in paleography of the inscriptions as well as the notations which are used in the inscriptions. So the notations, these shapes of notations are almost same which you find up to 19th century when he was talking about the textbooks, early textbooks used by the British administrators and the schools run by the British administrators. And these texts, they use notations which are almost similar. So I think most of the Kanakadiharam texts might go back to, there may be some earlier texts, but those texts are not available. But that practices which are mentioned in these texts might go back to this time, because these problems which are raised in the inscriptions, the accounting practices which we infer from these inscriptions, they can be explained only on the basis of the Kanakadiharam texts, because we do not have any contemporary text to explain these things, and the Sanskrit texts, they are not useful in this case. Actually, the Sanskrit texts are concerned with higher mathematics, astronomical and other things. These day-to-day practices are not found in the Sanskrit texts, and these are all mostly, everything are in the local language and local practices. So for this, we have either to rely on Kanakadiharam texts or the school textbooks which are used in the late 19th century or early 20th century. Most of the fractions, we have large number of fraction tables. So there I will go to the next thing. Can I take some terms? The land extent in all these three categories is Now I come to the other interesting thing which I started discussing. So we have this inscription in the inscriptions, large number of numbers and fractions in notation, in the form of notation, measures in the case of measures. We have, as I said, there are minute fractions less than 1/320. So that is those days we don't have, they are not used in numbers, they don't have the system of the modern calculation method using denominator and numerator system. So only by notations they have to calculate, but they use very, very small fractions in the inscriptions. Particularly in the 11th century, we have come across such minute fractions. As I said, the standardization process can explain the reason for the existence of these fractions, the small fractions. That may be the clue. Some inscriptions give such a large number of fractions. Two Tanjavur inscriptions, these are very famous inscriptions of the time, which are dated in 1014, give such minute details of land and tax assessment rates in 40 different villages. These 40 villages were given to the temple. Actually, the king gives all the income from the 40 villages to the temple. So when the income is described, the inscription refers to the extent of the land in each of the 40 villages and the land which was actually cultivated and the land which was not cultivated. That is, there were three categories. The whole extent of the village is given, including the residence and cultivated fields, wasteland, everything. That is the whole extent. Then what was the actually cultivated land? Because only cultivated land is useful for the government for tax purpose. So what they call taxable land. So this is second category. Then they give the third category, which is not taxed, which is exempted from tax. So in that way, they give three kinds of categories. But these things are given. They do not provide the classification details. Actually, whether the lands which are cultivated lands, whether they were standard lands or ordinary lands, that are not mentioned. But from the we can infer that the measurements given are standard lands, standard measurements. From a comparison of tax rates, that I come to that conclusion. The land details contain the total extent of the land, the extent of the land that was excluded as non-taxable, and the extent of taxable land. Finally, the quantity of grain, which is actually paddy, fixed as tax on the taxable land is given in terms of column, that liquid measure, and its subdivisions. In a few commercial villages, there are very few, the tax was fixed in terms of gold units. Well, that we need not consider here. The land extent in all the three categories is found up to the minutest fractions of the third order, and in a few cases, up to the fourth order. So I have given that in a table form. The description of the village land is given. So you can see the table. Actually, it is not given in the here, or I can show you. You see this first column, it is as given in the inscriptions. So they don't use notations in this inscription. All the fractions are given only by names. So total extent is given. That I have converted into modern numbers. So then what is exempted, and then we have the taxable land. So here you see total and of two, these are given in names, Irma, Arai, Mundrihai, Kilkale, Mukkani, Kilmukkale, Urmao. These are converted into modern numbers. So in modern numbers, you find in the second line, it is the first order fraction, that is Kil Mundri, which is called less than one Mundri, one by 320. They call it call of 1320, 1/320, and 3/80 of 1/320. It's a small fraction. And again, you have the third fraction, third order fraction, that is 1/320, 1/320, like that. So actually here, they simply mention by keel. So first keel, 1/320. Second keel means twice you have to multiply. And then the less, the deducted land, which is not taxed, that you find in the fourth thing you see, fourth order is given. Very small bit of land is, which is called Kil Mukkale Oruma, you find. So this Kil means just 1/320, 1/320, like that. You have to multiply four times. Then that is 3/4 of this much and 1/20 of this much. So in all cases, the notations, the names are just additive. They don't use any symbols for addition. So only by context you have to say this have to be added. Mukkale iranduma kani means mukkal 3/4, you have to add 220, like that. So this plus mark is not found in the inscriptions. They don't use it. Even in the Kanakadiharam text, they don't use it. But only by the context and by the wording, you have to infer it is addition. And for deduction, they have some other thing, Nichi, something is there. But here, they don't use, they simply say Nichi, that is, from that, this is deducted. And the fourth thing is, I mean, the last thing is here. As far as these fractions are concerned, even though these look very complicated, if you write by notations, you can deduct each one easily. So from that keel, this keel, you can easily deduct. They have some kind of algorithm, rhythm, to deduct one by one stage with another stage. So the case of deduction and also addition are not difficult in the case of these fractions, as given in either words or notations. That is very easy. But only when they go for multiplying or dividing, it's very complicated. I do not know how I think Rai should explain how this algorithm was followed. I think Babu also discusses in his thesis. They don't explain the way the fractions were factorized. So they have to divide the fractions with manageable factors, and then only they can deduct. They cannot deduct as it is. I mean, they cannot multiply as it is. But deduction and adding is very easy. There is no such factorization is easy. By mentally they can do it. But I don't know how they did all these things. When I wanted to check it, I had to use a calculator. I think otherwise it is not manageable easily. And after using calculator, I find it very accurate. Sometimes it may be maybe some 0.002, maybe there will be difference. Because they don't go by decimals. I mean, they use only their own kind of additions. So for them, I think it is correct. But when we do it in calculation, there is a kind of accuracy rate according to each calculator. So then some points are different, but otherwise it is almost accurate up to 99.99%. That much we can see when we see the calculations. And then so this is converted into grain. The taxable land is now given in, the tax is given so much units on this taxable land in column. So this is a column, 1,169 column, 2 tuni, 2 nali, 1 uri. So if you go to the liquid measure table, you will find these fractions. This is again mentioned only in numbers, in words. In words it is mentioned, I have converted into this. And the last denomination is 1 uri. Usually in the 40 villages which I checked, nadi is the last denomination. It seems they avoided the fractions less than nadi generally, because it is very small unit. Very small unit, it cannot be, it is not measured. They use only column measure, marakal. Marakal is 1/12 of the actual measure. And that is the measuring vessel. And small vessels they don't use for this purpose. Only in small transactions they use small vessels. But here in government measuring, they use only that marakal, which is 1/20. So they don't need the small quantity. Even then, they use up to 1 uri. 1 uri is 1/16 of the thing. I have given that in modern terms. In modern terms, you see, the one column is 170 liters, one kurini is 14 liters, and one nadi is 1.775 liters. this is very small, and up to one nadi they use in the inscription. So as mentioned earlier, the smallest fraction of a veli in the primary series is a mundiri. This is equal to 83.6 square meters. If a veli is taken, equivalent to 6.6 acres or 2.68 acres in modern terms. In the secondary series, it comes to 0.26 square meters. In the tertiary series, the smallest fraction is 0.81 square centimeter. And in the fourth, it is equal to 0.002 square centimeter. It's absolutely impossible to even visualize this small area. It may easily be noticed that the fractions of the second, third, and fourth order are so minute that it is humanly impossible to measure them with the rods available in the medieval times. That's not possible even by using modern precision instruments. This problem can be explained to a great extent on the basis of the standardization which I have mentioned earlier. Sometimes they might have given some notional area also to some unusable land, very small corners or small rock, where a land with a rock that they did not measure. It is so much small land. They put it in some fraction. That way they might have used that thing. So the problem now, as I said, so this is the thing to be discussed for, I think, those who are well versed in mathematics, they have to explain these things. As far as the fractions are concerned, the additions and subtractions, they pose not much difficulty. In the case of multiplication, division, some complicated algorithms are to be used. How are they handled? This is we have to find out the solution. How are the people involved in the calculation, say the accountants at the village level and those at the higher level, were trained in these complicated procedures? Actually, the discussion usually in the case of Kanakadiharam texts, there is a belief that all these Kanakadiharam, which are found in all the local languages, Tamil, Malayalam, and other things, they were derived from Sanskrit literature, Sanskrit scientific literature. That is the explanation usually given. But actually, these are practices made by the local accountants using the local language, local fractions. And these fractions are not found in the Sanskrit literature. These names or notations are not found in the Sanskrit literature. So these were developed in the local areas by the people, and such things are found in the other linguistic areas also. So this, how were they trained in using these fractions? Using the calculations using these notations and such things. This as because we don't have the contemporary pedagogical literature, we are not able to get such information, but that may be from the later texts we can get some understanding. Then the other thing is, from analysis of the teaching material and methods, I think Babu has given some explanation that they had to use their memory very well. So for memorizing, they had to use some methods which were recollective and associative memory, and which were constantly practiced. That may be used, that might have been the practice in the pedagogy involved. But anyway, these things, we do not know how these people were practicing at that time. So this is a question which we have to discuss. There is practically no information regarding this in contemporary inscriptions or literature. The other question is, this is again a puzzling question. Actually, all over India, even modern state of Karnataka, just on the borders, they were using the place value system, place value numbering system, because they were very much influenced by, in writing inscriptions, they were influenced to some extent by the Sanskrit idiom, Sanskrit area. And Tamil alone, they used independent of the Sanskrit influence. So this they used the old practice of additive numbers, numbers writing just by side by side, and thinking that they have to be added. So they don't have this nine numbers plus zero. This why they did not follow, why they followed the notation system. So this notation system was followed up to 19th century. Only after the British schooling system started, they put it in English, the modern methods. And there was one stage where you have elementary textbooks where you have notation system plus side by side you have the modern system. That's very interesting. The transition stage is very interesting. But for us, to deal with these inscriptions, those textbooks are very useful. And many things we can explain from these two, the inscriptional material. So with this, I will just conclude. And if there is any discussion, we can later discuss. Thank you very much. Yes.
I have many questions, but I'll ask one or two.
Yeah.
One is a general one and one is a specific one. The general one is, you know, it's a reflection on what do we put behind the word standardization. And coming from, you know, the world, the cynical world of Sanskrit literature, I was wondering if in certain cases that you were presenting here, there was not some, what was called standardization was maybe, you know, the giving of a same name of different sizes of a same measuring unit as a way of, you know, enforcing inequality. And like, for instance, one of my questions was the, you know, the government, Chola government imposed rod bigger than the rod used in the villages? So that would be like a way of saying, you know, the government gets to measure higher things. So that was one. One question, and the other is a very specific one. Is I didn't understand well the process of folded, and I forgot the name.
Yeah.
And I wanted to understand how. I didn't understand the way that. You take a field, and then if you want to understand how much it yields in capacities of grains, how it becomes smaller. I think you say there's a shrinkage. So
yeah.
The land is shrinked because of the, when you try?
On paper, yeah.
So.
Yeah.
No, I know, of course, but yeah. I want to understand, you know, it's a, it's in the interest of the Brahmins and of the state, of the government, that they get the most they can, right?
Yeah.
From the thing. So what's going on in the shrinking then? So that's
yeah,
a bit my question.
Okay. Well, standardization, as I said, it's not standardizing the measures, everything. Actually, the government introduced a measure which will be applied everywhere. Say either linear measure or grain measure. The government measure is there, so whenever the officials go there, so this is our measure, linear measure, and this thing. Your measure is this much. So how much your measure will be in terms of our measure? So first when they negotiate for tax purposes, they first fix the ratio of the local measure to the standard, this measure. So this is only for the occasion, for government when they collect the taxes. And the village accountant, he has his own accountancy. And the same thing, when the government officer writes, he will write his own accounts. So they don't tally, only unless you know the ratio of the village account to government account, you cannot explain that. So that is this ratio they fix. Anyway, for state purpose, they use one unit, either for land or other things. So that is the standard. And maybe after the 13th century, that measure was given up because another dynasty followed. and there was a break also. Then when the Vijayanagar, there is another big state which came up in the 14th century. For three centuries more they ruled. They introduced another system because it comprised the whole of South India, three linguistic areas. And they introduced another system, and that system somehow survived up to the British times, because that is immediate to the colonial times. So many of the denominations in coins and also land measures, they took up some earlier things, but they had introduced their own system that prevailed in up to the 19th century times. So these things were, of course, changing over time. As far as the Chola time is concerned, they used a standard measure for tax purposes, not for the local people. That is the thing. And regarding this shrinking, well, the government can exploit by putting their own figures, but actually they had some figures that they mentioned. Well, this categorization, that is grading of land, first category, second category, that is done at the village level, and that is written on the village registers. So it is only after negotiating with the local people regarding the quality of the land, they fix the grade. And they say until for some time, they should not change this grading. So in that way, it is some agreement is there. Of course, this exploitation is there. You find now and then, and particularly in the later times, we find sometimes they increase the scale of land. I mean, the length of the scale. So if they measure, instead of a 18-foot rod, if they measure 20-foot rod, the name of the valley will be same, but the extent will be much. So for government purpose, it is useful for getting more taxes. So that way, and people also revolt against such increasing the land arbitrarily. They say you should not. So there are such problems also there. So when the grading is done, some 10 hectares of land will be considered as equal to 1 hectare of land. So this is a kind of shrinking. That is what I meant. So it is only calculation. It is not actual thing. It is calculation. Thank you.
I also have thousands of questions, but yeah. I will only ask two.
Yeah. Yes.
But couldn't we imagine that, in fact, computation dealt with these names and directly with measurement values and not with these numbers?
Yeah, that's possible. Yeah. So this is only to explain here. I have converted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, there was one question. And
yeah, mostly this Kanakadiharam text, which I mentioned, which Roy will be talking about it. They use such methods. And actually, his whole thesis is on that problem. How, actually, well, from the inscriptions, I do not have any evidence. Only from the later practices, I just infer that. Yeah.
Established a new curious, what I was interested is, so while there being different absolute values used in different villages and by the government, it seems that at least they are using the same units, and in most cases, apart from the Kuli Veli system, the ratios were also the same. So I was very curious how these units were established. Was the Tola state trying to standardize the units being used? And the second question, I only have two questions. The second question is, you mentioned, so the examples you gave were the measurements between the local and by the official. I was interested whether there was a case where there were cases where two different villages, two different locals had to communicate and converse the different units.
Yeah, well, that happened. These things were there. Sometimes a land in this village is given to a temple in another village. So when they have to give grain from this land to another temple in the other village, naturally they have to negotiate how much would be there. But some such references are there. So by this village measure so much, by this village measure so much, so this much. And they say when it is decreased, that is when the quantity is less, they say you have to compensate for the less. So there is a particular word, what's called wasi, depreciation. In English we call depreciation. So you have to add so much quantity. And even in the case of this government measure, they say you have to add so much. If it is just 12 units, you have to add a quarter unit more to account for the difference. So that is there. As far as the changes from Chola period to later period, the names of the denominations, the Veli, etc., they are same. There is no change. But as far as the measures are concerned, the linear measures and grain measures, there is some change. And again, and as far as the coins are concerned, they use different kinds of different numismatic system. So that is more simple than the earlier system. Earlier, they used both weights as well as coins. It is in between. Sometimes they use just by gold weights, sometimes by coins. Coins were not much as far as the Chola period is concerned. And there also in the later period, we have a number of coins increases. Earlier it was more natural economy. But in the case of the 14th, 15th, 16th centuries, it becomes more money economy. So coins are used in every context. So in that way, there is such a difference.